Hans Memling was born in Seligenstadt in Germany. He moved to Bruges in Flanders, where he had a workshop for approximately 30 years. We don't know when he was born. We know that he could have been born no later than January 31st, 1465, by our dating. That's because that's the year he purchased his citizenship. That's the date he purchased his citizenship in Bruges, and the age of majority was 25 years old. But he certainly could have been born earlier. We do know that he died August 11th, 1494. Now, he's German by birth. He comes from this wonderful little town called Seligenstadt. Today, it still has many of the old buildings, including a building that is believed to have been owned by some of his maternal relatives. You can't visit it. Someone lives there. But it's a lovely little town, maybe about 20 miles from Frankfurt on Main. Now, we have the record of citizenship. He purchased his citizenship in Bruges on January 31st, 1465, by modern dating. Many of these late medieval and Renaissance towns actually began the new year on March 25th. That's Annunciation Day, the day of the Feast of the Annunciation, the day that honors the beginning of the era under grace, when they believed that Christ first took on human flesh, that God took on human flesh, the incarnation. And of course, today we will begin our dating of the next year in January. So for those first few months, there's a discrepancy between the 15th century dating and the modern dating. Now, we have a number of documents about Hans Memling. They show that he was prosperous, probably the height of his prosperity about 1480, when he had to pay some taxes that some of the most wealthy people had to. I think it was the 200 and, I've forgotten the exact number now, but 200 and some wealthiest people were paying. We see him purchasing a house. He had a wife, and he had three sons, and his wife died. We know that he had not only patrons from the lowlands, but international patrons. Many of his works were acquired by Italians. The Italians really seemed to love his work. Also, patrons from the Hanseatic League, and there seems to have been some interest in him in Spain. And as I said, we have a document that tells us that he died August 11th, 1494 in Bruges. Now, how did he get from Seligenstadt to Bruges? Well, we don't know, except for speculation. But we think that he was probably in Roger von der Weyden's workshop in Brussels. There aren't any documents, and the reason for that is because the Brussels archives burnt. So, during the 30 Years' War. So, the records are gone. But we do have some indications that Memling may have been either a pupil or a journeyman in Roger von der Weyden's workshop. He has a number of works that are based on Roger von der Weyden's. Now, that in itself doesn't prove anything because everybody copied Roger's work. But he does know Roger's work from many points, many times in Roger's career, and works of art that we know where they were, and they were in different locations. They were in Bonn, they were in Middelburg, they were in Cologne. So knowing that suggests that Hans Memling may have had access to Roger van der Weyden's pattern drawings. So even if a painting had left the workshop before Memling arrived, he might have seen the drawings. And he might have copied them. And we know that this is how artists trained. It's not just Memling, it's all of the artists. They train by copying their master's work. And some of them, you know, go on to their own styles and ideas. And I think that Memling did that. Something that's also been discovered is that the underdrawings of paintings that are considered to be early in Memling's career, some of the linear quality relates to Roger van der Weyden's style. And then as Memling develops, you know, his underdrawings, well, they get very, very scribbly, actually, which is fascinating, actually. And Molly Ferries has documented this and shown the relationship between early Memling's underdrawings and Roger van der Weyden's style, which suggests that he was active in Roger's workshop. There is one art historian who thinks that he was not in the workshop, and she says, we don't have any documents. But you know, you can't prove a negative. If the archives have burnt, does that mean that nobody was anybody's master? The archives don't give us that information because they were destroyed. And you know, we can't just say that someone wasn't a pupil because there are no archival documents. Archival documents which no longer exist. Now, Memling is known for a number of things. He's particularly known for his beautiful paintings of the Virgin Mary and the charming female saints. And these are often very ideal, serene figures. When I say ideal, I don't mean ideal in the classical sense. This is within the context of Netherlandish naturalism and naturalistic detail. You'll also notice we have here a detail from a picture we'll see later, Madonna and Child, where the Christ Child has gained a little weight from Roger van der Weyden's children, who you may remember were a little scrawny. Memling's Christ children are always plump. They're cute little kids. And he does seem to show the love of Mary and the Christ Child. There seems to be this wonderful connection between them. He's also known for his landscape backgrounds, both historiated landscapes behind sacred scenes. And when I say historiated, I mean that it has stories or little scenes in the background that tell us the stories of the saints, but also landscape backgrounds behind portraits. And he really popularizes this idea of the landscape, beautiful landscape background behind usually a bust length figure of a man or a woman. He is also known for his portraiture. His portraits make everyone look dignified and devout without flattery. What he uses frequently is a kind of diffuse lighting. And then, as we'll see when we look at these works, you'll see he still continues that tradition of using naturalistic detail, including reflections. Now, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about Memling's reputation and the reevaluation of Memling. And I'm just going to try to summarize this. During his lifetime, he had a very high reputation and, as we've said, international clientele. There is a wonderful quotation. When Memling died, his death was recorded in a diary or a chronicle by Rompart de Duperre from Bruges. And this was copied in the 16th century, about 1540, into another manuscript. And that's where we know Memling's death date, because on the entry for August 11th, 1494, it says, on this day died Hans Memling, who was then proclaimed the most excellent and accomplished painter in all the Christian world. Well, that's high praise indeed. Was it the praise of the chronicler? Or, because it says, was then proclaimed, was that the praise that was given by the 16th century copyist? But in any case, it does show that Memling had an outstanding reputation in his own lifetime and shortly thereafter. Now, it wasn't just Memling that was less known, perhaps less revered from the 16th to the 18th century. You can see most of the Flemish 15th century artists are somewhat forgotten. And there are some references. Certainly, Vasari, van Mander, and in the 17th century, Sandras has seen some Memlings and talks about them. But for the most part, they were less interested in these 15th century Flemish artists until the 19th century. And in the 19th century, there was a romantic revival of what they called the Flemish primitives. And at that time, the artists who were considered to be the greatest from this period were Jan van Eyck and Hans Memling. And Memling was probably the most revered, the most popular artist. His fame was more than Roger van der Weyden's. And Weill says of him that Jan van Eyck saw with his eyes, but Memling with his soul. And he was kind of conceived of as the exemplar of medieval piety. This continued into the early 20th century, but after the First World War, Memling's reputation, well, some of the most famous art historians had negative things to say about him. And I think part of it was the change in what they were interested in perception, essentially. For example, people were often more cynical. They often say that the old veracities were challenged by, you know, this horrendous world war. And people's attitudes were quite different. A lot of changes were going on. In art history, they got very interested in some of the artists who were, a bit outre. Bosch, with all of his demons. Or Hugo van der Hoes, with his mental distress. And Memling was conceived as, you know, he's so ideal, so perfect, so serene. Friedlander, the great connoisseur of early Netherlandish painting, Friedlander calls him the shallow stream that never surprises. Although he does like his portraiture. He does speak highly of portraiture. Panofsky says he's the very model of a major minor master. And both of them speak of him as though he is unoriginal. You know, that he's copying what Roger van der Weyden did. What seemed odd to me was there are artists who copy what Memling does, and Friedlander does not take them to tasks for being unoriginal. And in fact, every artist of the 15th century borrowed from the artists who had gone before. They borrowed particularly from Jan van Eyck and especially from Roger van der Weyden. The question is, what do they do with their borrowings? And my answer to that is that Memling transforms what he's learned from Roger and puts it in his own vocabulary, if you will. He may not be saying the same thing. He may not be always emphasizing the suffering of Christ, although he does have paintings like that. But he does give new interpretations. In fact, the example I have right here is not in your textbook, but I just think this is such a wonderful little painting. It's the left wing of a painting in the Hospital of St. John in Bruges called the Florens Triptych. And this is showing you a kind of combination of scenes. You see the little baby Jesus has just been born. It's a nativity. And he's lying on the edge of Mary's mantle. And you remember that from Roger van der Weyden's Bladelin Nativity. There's usually two gestures that you see. Well, sometimes three. Sometimes the Virgin has her hands raised in adoration. Sometimes the hands are closed as though she's praying. And you'll remember that Roger van der Weyden had the hands pointing to the Christ child. What Memling has done with this is open up Mary's hands as she reaches down for the Christ child. So she's essentially combining that gesture where the hands are open in wonder and also where it's pointing down, but it gives it a very different meaning. This is the meaning of the mother who loves her child, who's going to pick up the child, she's going to succor him, she's going to nurse him. And this actually does come out of St. Bridget, you know, after Mary has given birth to the Christ child. You know, she says, "Be welcome, my Lord and my God," and then she reaches down and picks up the child. But that gesture gives you, I'd say, multiple meanings in a very simple gesture. Adoration, the love of mother and child. And it also draws our attention to the small baby Jesus. Okay, as you can see, I don't agree with the view of Memling as unoriginal. And you'll find from about the late 1960s on, there were several people who made a positive re-evaluation of Memling. A number of people called for it. One of the reasons was because they started looking at Memling's underdrawings and they would see, you know, these wonderful, smooth, calm surfaces and this, scribbly, active underdrawing. So there's got to be more to Memling than we thought, I guess, was the idea. But Charles Cutler wrote a textbook called Northern Painting, and in it he said that, you know, Memling was really interested in artistic problems, and he, you know, talked about this idea of, you know, Memling being really, you know, a much better artist than Friedlander or Panofsky thought. My dissertation, which I wrote as a dissertation, I got my PhD in 1979, and then a couple years later in 1981, it was published. And one of the themes for this was the reevaluation of Memling. I wrote about the paintings in the Hospital of St. John in Bruges. And to show his originality, I would compare it with the works of art that he supposedly derived his compositions or ideas from, and show how he reinterpreted them, just as I was talking about this gesture in the Nativity. In 1994, Dirk de Vos, who was the curator at the Groningen Museum in Bruges, wrote this very large, wonderful book on Memling. The complete works. Okay, I can think of a couple that he didn't get in, but the almost complete works of Memling. And he said that he was the first to do a reevaluation, but he wasn't. You could say he was the first to do a reevaluation of the entire oeuvre, or most of the works of Memling. But he does say that he will not compare. he will simply assert. And so, of course, my method was compare to prove, and now he feels that he can simply assert that Memling is an original and accomplished painter. I might say that at the time when my dissertation was coming out, Defoe's had a very different, his published work had a different attitude toward that. And he was still calling Memling unoriginal at the time. And since then, there's been another book by Barbara Lane, which has come out. Now, I mentioned the idea that Memling was not a pupil of Roger van der Weyden. Barbara Lane is the person who holds that. And I will just say, I don't think many people agree with her on that. But she has many really interesting things in that book. In your textbook, there's two paintings that are two works of art that come from the Hospital of St. John in Bruges. There actually are four works of art, paintings, that can be found in the St. Jan's Hospital, or the Hospital of St. John. And you can see I've listed all four. The altarpiece of the two St. Johns, and you can see it's in boldface, so we're going to talk about that. That's in your text. One of my very favorite paintings by Memling is the Florens Adoration of the Magi Triptych, of which I just showed you the Nativity wing, but it's not in your text. I was so tempted to put it in, but I restrained myself. The Adrian Renz Lamentation Triptych, and the Ursula Shrine, which is also in your text, and so we're going to be talking about that. So I have the two that are from your textbook in boldface. I might also tell you that the picture that you're looking at right now of Saint Veronica is the outside of the Florens Adoration of the Magi Triptych, one of the wings. Saint John the Baptist is on the other side. But I thought it gave you a lovely idea of Memling's beautiful Saint Veronica in this lovely landscape where you have the winding road and the bushes and trees and then the very, very hazy mountains in the background. Let's look at the painting known by several titles. The altarpiece of the two St. Johns. Remember, this is St. John's Hospital. Originally, looking at the seals, the hospital was actually founded in 1188. It's one of the oldest, maybe the oldest, but certainly one of the oldest continually operating hospitals in Europe. There is actually a new St. John's Hospital, which is, I gather, a modern high-rise outside the city now. But continuing the same tradition in a sense. The painting is also known as the Mystic Marriage of St. Catherine, because you see St. Catherine, and we'll look at a detail of her in a bit, sort of in the foreground receiving the ring from the Christ child. And, if you're saying, what is it? It's the Virgin and Child with saints and angels. But there's so many paintings by Memling and other artists that are the Virgin and Child with saints and angels that's a little vague. And it's not just the Mystic Marriage of St. Catherine. That's one detail, one part of the center panel. But you can see that we have the two St. Johns, St. John the Baptist and St. John the Evangelist, both in the center, and scenes from their life and death on either side, and the two wings. Now, the hospital was originally, we think, dedicated to St. John the Evangelist. At least his attributes are on the earliest seals. But by the 15th century, we have seals showing St. John the Baptist, and we have a little Agnus Dei, a Lamb of God sculpture that is on passageway above the passageway between the old construction of the hospital ward and the new construction of the 15th century. At any rate, it shows a symbol that we associate with John the Baptist. So by the 15th century, both of the two St. Johns were the patrons of the hospital. So they're shown here. And we believe that this was the altarpiece for the, I guess you call it the high altar, the main altar in the hospital chapel. Now, that hospital, St. John's Hospital, or St. John's Hospital, it's also sometimes known as the Memlink Museum today, because it has been transformed into a museum. Just to show you here, on this is a 16th century map, and you see where it says 47. This is the Hospital of St. John. They built a new residence for the sisters in the 16th century, so not all of those buildings would have been here. But you can see that it goes along the river. And right across the street is the Church of Our Lady, Unsere Liebe Frau, or Notre Dame. The street, in fact, is Mary Street. Now, here we're looking, as we're looking down the street, and we're seeing the outside of the hospital. You see these two gables, and you also see a projection, now sort of a polygonal projection going out onto maybe the sidewalk today. That is the new apse of the hospital chapter. When I say new, I mean new in Memlink's time. It was built between 1473 and 74. And on the other side of that wall would be where Memlink's altarpiece of the two St. Johns would have been placed. And here's that passageway that I was talking about that goes between the two parts of the hospital. And they tell me that the room above it served as the archives, it serves as the scriptorium. And then we have a 18th century picture of the ward. Now, why 18th century? Well, it's similar to what would have been there earlier. The style of clothing may have changed a little bit. You'll see that the sisters have their sort of the waists are cinched in, and they have skirts that, you know, seem to have petticoats or something underneath them rather than simpler garments of the 15th century. But modern medicine doesn't really start until the later 19th century. So the hospital care still is in what we might consider to be a medieval mode. And what I want you to notice here is how they have this ward. And incidentally, the ward just kept growing. They kept adding on to it. But you can see that you have open arches, and then one place a colonnade, with these enclosed beds on either side. This is where the sick people would be. And then if you look upper left, you're looking into the hospital chapel. And the point that I want to make is that the hospital chapel was open. There wasn't a wall separating it from the ward where the patients were. Because one of the most important things about a medieval hospital or Renaissance hospital was the spiritual care that was given. And one of the things they had to do was the patients were supposed to participate in the divine office. They're supposed to hear the mass. They're supposed to hear all of the services that would go on 8 times during the day and night that were the canonical hours or the divine office. If they're well enough, you know, they can get up and go into the chapel. If they aren't, you know, they can hear, we hope. And so I want to talk to you about the hospital context in a bit. We talked a bit about the medieval hospital with Roger van der Weyden's Last Judgment. And you'll remember that a medieval hospital is quite a bit different than a modern hospital. For one, of course, we wouldn't expect it to have what we would consider scientific medication. They're not going to have antibiotics. Those actually come in the 20th century. Also, who goes to the hospital? These hospitals were charitable hospitals. In the case of the Hospital of St. John, it was a municipal hospital, it was a city hospital, but it was staffed by religious, by brothers and sisters who took their vows of poverty, chastity, obedience, and followed the Augustinian order, the rule of St. Augustine. The hospital had two missions, if you will. One was the care of the destitute ill, and the other was to give travelers one night's lodging, food and lodging. They couldn't just stay there, but you know, if you were traveling, you could stop at a hospital. Now, I said the destitute ill. If a person had a home, if they had a family, or if they had enough money to pay for, say, servants to take care of them, they stayed at home to be treated, to, you know, get well or to die, to call in the priest or the physician. It was only the very poorest people who would usually go to a hospital. Now, someone who couldn't afford to hire someone or didn't have enough family members or didn't even have a house where he or she could be treated. Now, where does disease come from? You know, we might say germs. And they did understand something about contagion, but they didn't know the process. They thought it might be foul air, for example. But it was believed that both death and disease were caused by original sin. So, yes, you know, you might have the good care of the sisters in the hospital, and they may know herbal medicines. You very rarely would call in a physician. But how are you really going to be cured? You're going to be cured by the intervention of Christ and the saints. And frankly, when you come into a medieval hospital, there's a good chance you'll die, but you'll probably be more comfortable than you would dying in a hovel or on the street. And you might be cured and return to the world and die later. One thing's certain, you're going to die, whether it's sooner or later. And so the goal of the medieval hospital was not only caring for the bodily needs of the ill, but the goal was to help them make a good death. Now, what does that mean? It means that they will have a chance to avail themselves of the sacraments, of confession, of extreme unction, taking their last communion, so that their sins will be wiped out and they will go directly to heaven or perhaps spend less time in purgatory. And purgatory was conceived of as a place, except for limbo, we didn't, you know, have any pain, but it was conceived of rather like hell, but temporary. Your hope was that you eventually would be purged of your sins and would go to heaven, but you didn't want to spend time in purgatory. So making a good death when you can say confession and be absolved of your sins, you can avail yourselves of the various sacraments and that will help you go to heaven, that was so important. In fact, when a person first entered the hospital, the first thing they did, you know, what do they do in the United States? First thing, you're coming in, you're sick, you're in pain. What do they ask you? They say, how are you going to pay for this? Do you have insurance? That's not what they did at a medieval hospital. The first thing they did was call the priest. And there was a priest or priests attached to the Hospital of St. John. They had a nearby house. Interestingly enough, I say they rarely called upon physicians, called upon the priest all the time. In an earlier period, the priest had other duties to the parish, and eventually it was decided that no, his duties were only to the hospital. But by the 15th century, he was the priest for the brothers and sisters and for the patients. So the first thing, you're brought in, if you are conscious, you would make your confession. You'd be absolved of your sins. If you were not conscious, you probably would receive extreme unction, or certainly at least the anointing of the sick. The spiritual care was just as important, in fact, was more important than the bodily care. And part of that is the receiving of the sacraments, confession, the Mass, and also the divine office, and also relics and artwork could be seen as part of hospital care. And I know I've sometimes said to myself, well, all these Netherlandish paintings have as their theme salvation. But certainly the art in a hospital has a particularly strong impetus to be worried about your salvation because, you know, you are in danger of death. And I might also point out that the care and this concern was also for the religious who served in the hospital. I mean, they wanted to go to heaven. They were trying to follow the acts of mercy that you see in Matthew 25. They were caring for the sick. They were feeding the hungry, giving drink to the thirsty. They probably clothed some of the people who may not have had enough clothing to keep them warm. They would bury the dead. Pretty much everything except visiting the prisoner. Welcoming the stranger. They welcomed in the travelers. So, you know, they were fulfilling most of the acts of mercy that Christ says are necessary for someone to come into heaven. Okay. This is the hospital, this is the altarpiece of the two St. Johns. And we talked about in the center, you know, we have the Virgin and Child. We have four saints, St. John the Baptist on the upper left, St. John the Evangelist, upper right, and then kneeling on either side of Mary and the Christ Child, St. Catherine of Alexandria and St. Barbara. And then, as you can see, there's two little angels, one making music, the other one is holding up a book for the Virgin to read. On the right side, the wing that would fold over, shows the decapitation or the beheading of John the Baptist. And if you remember the John the Baptist, the beheading of John the Baptist by Roger van der Weyden, you can see that there certainly is a resemblance here. In which executioner is shown from the back. He's somewhat angular. There's a little bit where you're seeing, you know, a gap between his hose and his jerkin. It's not quite as exaggerated as Roger. It's cleaned up a little, smoothed up a little. But there's certainly that would have been the source that he's changed slightly. Then on the other side is this remarkable painting of the vision of St. John the Evangelist, the vision of the Apocalypse, or the Book of Revelation, which is supposed to be a vision that John had when he was exiled to the island of Patmos. Now, the altarpiece closes. And it probably would have been closed except for maybe for Mass when it would be opened. And on the outside, we see the donors and their patron saints. Now, I should also tell you that the patients were supposed to, they were required to say prayers for for their benefactors, for the brothers and sisters who cared for them, for the civic authorities and the ecclesiastical authorities who presided over the Hospital of St. John. And by this time, the financial aspects were presided over by the city. And they had special people who were appointed, the guardians, to watch over that. And there was also the Bishop of Tournai was supposed to sort of preside over the personnel, who are, of course, religious. He also was allowed to review the finances, the annual report of the finances. So here we see, these were the two top male and female officers, if you will, of the religious. Anthony Schwagers was the spiritual master, and Jakob de Kunick was the bursar. Anthony Schwagers actually died before this was completed. So it gives us some idea. He died in 1475, I believe. So we think that it was commissioned probably about 1474 when they finished the addition to the chapel that put that little apse in, and they wanted a brand new altarpiece. And you can see them with their patron saints, Saint Jakob or Saint James, shown as a pilgrim, a hermit saint, Saint Anthony, Anthony Abbot, and then Saint Agnes, and you can see she has her little Agnes, her sheep or lamb there, and then holding a monstrous is Saint Clare, who is, of course, the Franciscan Saint Clare. And these are the name patrons of the people who are shown below. One way we can identify who they are. Okay, there is the hospital. There is the altarpiece of the Hospital of St. John in Bruges. The hospital, the altarpiece of the two St. Johns. And we're going to look at each section of this. In the center, we've talked about who is there. But as you look a little closer, you can see that you have a historiated landscape. In other words, a landscape that has scenes, and they are from the life, the death of the two St. Johns. And we'll take a closer look at those. Also, there's one that is a scene of contemporary life in Bruges, which is quite interesting. Mary is shown seated before a cloth of honor, and angels hold a beautiful crown flying above her head, so she doesn't have to wear the heavy crown. And you can see, of course, this beautiful tapestry. So it seems to be a kind of heavenly setting, sort of a heavenly loggia, the Virgin's throne room, something of that nature. These saints lived at different times. Catherine and Barbara were supposed to be early Christian martyrs. And of course, John the Baptist was the cousin of Christ, and John the Evangelist was his youngest of the disciples. Now, here's that scene where you see it called the mystic marriage of St. Catherine. St. Catherine had, I guess you could say, a vision in which she saw the Christ child appeared to her, and or Christ appeared to her and put a ring on her finger. So in that sense, she becomes the kind of exemplar for all of the nuns, or in this case, the hospital sisters, who are brides of Christ. You know, they don't marry some earthly person. Their devotion is to Christ. And I want you, when you're looking at St. Barbara, the lady in green, to look at that structure behind her. Of course, well, talk about that in a minute. There is St. Catherine of Alexandria, a virgin martyr. And one of the interesting things about Memling and some of the other artists is Memling very frequently has these musical angels with the musical instruments of the day. And I understand musical historians, you know, can sometimes get an idea of what the instruments were. This is a portative or portable organ. I also should say something. Three of these four saints were martyred, where they were killed. And Catherine and Barbara were early Christian martyrs. And it is believed that you can call upon a martyr to help you have a good death, because martyrs have the best death of all. They are baptized with their blood. They go directly to heaven. They do not pass purgatory. So, you know, they were assured of entry into heaven. So, you know, you could call upon them to help you make a good death. Now, here's St. Barbara. We talked about St. Barbara when we showed you the drawing by Jan van Eyck. And you'll remember that her attribute is a tower, the tower where she was supposed to be shut up by her father, and she changed the design. She told the workman to put in three windows in honor of the Holy Trinity. And then, of course, her father tried to kill her because she was a Christian. And eventually she was not killed by him. He was struck by lightning. And she was martyred. Now, St. Barbara then is another one of these martyrs who could be patrons to have a good death. In other words, that you'll confess, you'll be absolved of your sins, you'll receive extreme unction before you die. You will die in a state of grace, and you'll either go to heaven or at least you will spend less time in purgatory. But this tower, I mean, we can see on the side sort of the window with two window sections and then maybe a doorway below. It doesn't really have the three windows that we can see. It suggests that it might have more than that. That structure is very, very interesting. And let's take a closer look. Her tower is actually a monstrance. And a monstrance is a container to display the consecrated host. And as you can see, there's this sort of cylindrical glass container within. And you can see the rounded shape of a circular host, the consecrated bread from the sacrament. Now, there's a distinction, I guess, which could be overlapped. Maybe we wouldn't call it monstrous, maybe we'd call it a ciborium, which sometimes is a more architectural structure, you know, than a monstrance. And in those, they would keep the reserve hosts. And they sometimes were called towers, turris. The reserve host is that you have consecrated more than one host during the sacrament. You have leftover, if you will, hosts. And I can see this would be particularly important at a hospital where you would need to have a reserve host because, you know, someone might be in danger of death. The someone might need to receive the sacrament right then. And they don't have time to go through the whole Mass and consecrate another host, but they have these already displayed. So you might think about what this would mean to a person who is dying. If they could be well enough to get in and see this picture, they would be reminded of, you know, the sacrament that goes forth on the altar, and you know they would see what they believe to be the bread transformed into the body of Christ. You'll remember that the Mass reenacts the crucifixions and earns merits for salvation, and salvation is what it's all about. as I would say. Now here you can see some of the scenes behind St. John the Baptist. You might notice that John the Baptist is gesturing, pointing, as it were, toward the Christ child. And of course, he was the person who pointed to Christ and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." And the Lamb is standing right next to him. And then we see John the Evangelist blessing a chalice, and you can see a snake coming out of that. Well, the story was that he was fed poisoned wine, and he made the sign of the cross, and the poison departed in the form of a serpent, of a snake. So there is a kind of Eucharistic connection, too, because he's holding a chalice, from which he is removing the poison, and then sort of on the same side, you also have the tower with the host, the bread of the sacrament. Now, right behind them, you see scenes from, well, behind John the Baptist, you see a scene that we've seen in a large form, the burning of the bones of the Baptist. Well, here is burning of the body of the Baptist. Behind John the Evangelist is a scene from contemporary Bruges. There is the crane. This is a large crane, and we'll see a detail of it in a short period of time. And this, I think, was the one at Kronplatz. There was another one up at what is today called the Mini Water.
And
okay, here we can see the burning of the body of the Baptist, and you can see he's been decapitated, so they just have the body. Where is the head? There's the head. Remember the story of Herodias and St. Joanna burying the head of the Baptist, hiding him. So here is that hidden head in the wall there. And here is the scene behind John the Evangelist. And as I say, it's contemporary Bruges. They had these large cranes. And as you can see, people are walking in the wheel to turn it. You had a river coming from the coast, which at that time was large enough so that ships could come up and bring goods to Bruges. Bruges was a major cosmopolitan, international trading, banking, goods coming in, merchant place, merchant city. During the later 15th and 16th century, though, the river silted up, and no longer could the large ships come in, and both that and the displeasure of Maximilian of Austria pretty much ruined Bruges' economy, and the major trading center of Flanders then went from Bruges to Antwerp in the 16th century. But at this time, you've still got the crane here that would help unload the ships. And what we're seeing are barrels of wine and some of the brothers of the hospital gauging the wine, or testing, weighing it to see what taxes should be paid. And this was one of the privileges that the hospital had that produced income. They would charge a fee for the wine gauging. You had to decide what taxes people would pay when they import wine. So it had to be weighed and measured. And one of the brothers of the house was supposed to do that. And it was an honorable office to be the wine gauger. And it produced income not only for the city, but they also got a fee for the hospital. But remember, wine. Here's the contemporary use of wine. And, there's perhaps this Eucharistic idea, sort of, I guess you could say, at two levels. And then, also behind John, on the other side, we see a number of scenes. Incidentally, the man standing there has been, because of the wine gauging is going on the other side of the column, is thought to be the brother who gauged the wine. And then we see a little bit back, we see some scenes from the life of John the Evangelist. One of the things, he didn't die, but they tried to kill him. They boiled him in oil. And as you can see, he's standing there and nothing's happening. He's not dying. if you go way far back, you see John the Baptist in this opening, in this building, baptizing. And my guess might be that he's supposed to be baptizing the philosopher Cato, which was one of the stories told of him. And then, sort of between those two scenes, you see him being led with a soldier to a boat. He's going to be exiled to the island of Patmos, and we'll see what happens when we get there. Now we're going to look at the left wing, wing which shows the beheading or the decapitation of John the Baptist. I want to point out one thing as far as the condition of the painting. They did clean this painting, and they found that pretty much all of Salome's dress was overpaint. And there was a question about how are we going to restore this? Shall we, make it look like, try to make it look like it is, put folds and things like this to make it look like the green part of the dress, which is actually missing, is actually by Memling. Or should we just, color it in with blank, leave it? Or, and this is what they decided to do, something halfway in between. They used a color of green, little bits and pieces,
and also matching the bits and pieces that are the edge of the tapestry that you can, we'll take a closer look at in a bit. And they decided so that it wouldn't be a big gap in the painting, it looks strange to most people, they would sort of fill this in with the green about the shade they thought it was originally used, but they wouldn't put in all of the folds. You know, they keep it a little bit simpler. So it's not exactly flat, but, you know, if you are, you know, worried about whether, you know, Memling painted this section or whether it's a restorer, it's, that's all restorer. And the idea is it's not supposed to fool anyone. But you can see the beautiful head of Salome with her rich, bejeweled headdress and necklace and this beautiful transparent drapery that seems to just waft in the breeze. You know, it just forms another, what I say, beautiful shape. And then let's look way, way, way in the background there. And you can see there's a light with, I know it just looks like a little red dot here, but it's God the Father. And then we're going to look here at that landscape, the distance, and you can see how atmospheric it's becoming. Memling used the winding road and also here the winding river to draw our eyes back into space. And also, you know, with all those graceful curves add to the beauty of the landscape. Here we have John the Baptist baptizing Christ with an angel standing by holding Christ's garment. And then there are other figures on the other side of the river, possibly coming to be baptized. This is that detail where we're looking through the archway into the palace of Herod. And so we're seeing the Feast of Herod, and there is the tapestry with the you know, beautiful gold brocade, and it's edged with green velvet. And in the foreground, we're seeing the dance of Salome. Now, you know, it looks like a decorous dance. I think in the 19th and 20th century, people kind of envision it as a belly dance or something. But in the 15th century, it's quite a decorous little dance where she's, you can't even see her feet on this, but sometimes she kicks up one of her feet in the back, just a little bit, takes it off the ground. She's sort of holding up her skirt a little bit, presumably so she can dance. You all know she's dancing, not just walking, because you have the person playing the pipes and you know the story as well. The right wing is a really amazing scene of the apocalypse. It shows the vision of St. John the Evangelist, who's been exiled to the island of Patmos. And John is writing the book of Revelation. Book of Revelation is known both as the Apocalypse and the Book of Revelation. It's the last book of the Christian Bible. And it is, in it, John sees the one on the throne. He sees a book that has seven seals, and the Lamb breaks each seal, and devastation comes out over the earth. It's visionary. It's told in really phantasmagorical language. And yes, it's very poetic language, and it's very visual language. And, you know, throughout the Middle Ages, people have created works of the apocalypse. There's been manuscripts and tapestries. In fact, right up to the present day, people still use the Apocalypse or the Book of Revelation as a source for, you know, artistic inspiration. These subjects are still portrayed, and sometimes in very modern styles. Now, one of the things that's really unusual about this is original. This is unique because this is the first work of art to combine the apocalyptic images into one composition. Previously, in your manuscripts or your wall paintings or your tapestries, you would have sections, and, you know, sort of each vision, each section of the vision would be shown separately, sometimes with John the Baptist below. Here we have this unified composition where John is sitting there on the island, and then it's like the heavens are showing us many, many different parts of his vision. So let's take a closer look. He sees the one on the throne, which is surrounded by a rainbow. And that, of course, is believed to represent God, the throne of God. And the throne of God is surrounded by the four living creatures who sing Sancta, 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 holy, holy, holy. And you see them here at the base of the throne. You have the lion, the winged lion, the winged ox, the winged man or angel, and the eagle, who actually has wings, as you probably know, you may know them as the symbols of the four evangelists. But they come from the book of Revelation, and also Ezekiel has a similar vision. And then, surrounding the throne of God, you have the 24 elders of the apocalypse. So I've done a little quoting here. And behold, there was a throne set in heaven, and upon the throne one sitting. And there was a rainbow round about the throne. And round about the throne were 24 ancients sitting, clothed in white garments, and on their heads were crowns of gold. And they make music, and they take their crowns and they throw them on the crystal sea at the foot of the throne of God. And so here you see close up some of the 24 elders of the apocalypse. And here, of course, is one of the most famous images from the apocalypse, the four horsemen of the apocalypse. In the one detail, you're only seeing three of them, but we'll show you all of them. You can see also the stars falling from the sky. It looks like a giant meteorite, and a fire coming down from the sky, and people hiding and trying to get away from all of this devastation. And here, and I put each one of them so you can see them, are the four horsemen of the apocalypse. The man on the white horse is interpreted several different ways in Christian history. Earlier on, for example, in Carolingian period, sometimes interpreted as Christ. But by this point, the man with the bow and arrow was thought to bring plague or disease. The man on the red horse wields a sword. He is war. The man on the black horse with the balance is famine. And I always think of that as kind of the man who is weighing out the grain at a time of famine, and he's hoarded it, and he's charging high prices, and people are dying because they can't afford to have it. And then you see death on a pale horse. And here's a detail: death on a pale horse, and hell follows after. And so you see it's this sort of mummified skeletal face with a large, long arrow or a lance. And it says, and behold, a pale horse, and he that sat upon him, his name was Death, and hell followeth him. And so you see this great big monster mouth with fire coming out of it. And you see some of the damned within. And of course, in the Middle Ages, they often portrayed the entrance to hell as what is called a hell mouth. It's a giant monster mouth with fire and people being tormented within. And of course, that is the representation of hell following the horseman who represents death. And then here's these very strange creatures. Well, of course, Memling didn't make them up. They are described. They're called locusts, but they're described really as kind of chimera, made up of different parts. You'll see the star coming from the sky here, falling to the earth. And from the smoke of the pit there came out locusts upon the earth. And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle. And on their heads were, as it were, crowns of gold. And their faces were as the faces of men. And they had hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were as lions. I don't think we can quite see the teeth, but we see the human heads on the horse's body. And here's the woman clothed in the sun, which we've talked about the iconography of the woman clothed in the sun as Marian iconography. And here you can see, shown as a figure of Mary. And a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, and the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars.
And behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his head 7 diadems. And his tail drew the 1/3 part of the stars from heaven and cast them to the earth. So there is the dragon whose tail sweeps the stars from the sky, and he's threatening the woman clothed in the sun, who gives birth to a child. And an angel comes and takes the child up to heaven, and then the woman is giving the wings of an eagle to escape the dragon, who is pouring out water from its mouth. As I say, it's visual language. It makes perfect artwork. Although it's something you, like to say, would not see every day. Now, this is the other work of art that's shown in your textbook. It's known as simply the St. Ursula Shrine, but it is a reliquary. And a reliquary is a container for relics. Relics are the earthly remains of holy personages. It's made out of oak, it's been gilded, and then you can see along the ends and somewhat on the roof, as it were, because it's shaped like a little Gothic church. And along the sides, there are arches, and there are paintings by Hans Memling. And the paintings then are as though the little church had stained glass windows. But they're paintings of the story of St. Ursula and the 11,000 virgin martyrs of Cologne. And this, we're seeing it from now the other side. There are about 40 different relics that once were in the shrine. They are not there. They have been removed. There is the document of translation. In other words, when they moved the relics from one place to another, when this was first created. We know that it was dedicated on St. Ursula Day, October 21st, 1489. And the document lists all of the relics. There's things like milk of the Virgin Mary. There's earth from the Holy Lands. But the first thing that's named are bones of the 11,000 virgin martyrs of Cologne. Now, you see why it'd be very important to have a large number of relics, because relics were believed to heal. And I don't know about this hospital, but I did read about one hospital where there was a person whose job was to go around and bring the relics around to the sick and, just walk through the ward. And essentially the virtue was supposed to radiate and hopefully to heal people. This would be too big, I would think, for them to do that. But it would be probably in the church, in the chapel. And so it is not just a beautiful work of art. It also has a very important function within the religious context of the hospital. Now, St. Ursula was the leader of the 11,000 virgin martyrs of Cologne, and we'll talk about them in a moment. You will remember the patients would call on the saints for healing, particularly martyred saints. So now you have over 11,000 martyrs, maybe just the bones of a few of them in there. But these people were also pilgrim saints. And so, remember, we did also have travelers who might stay one night at the hospital. And they could appeal to the pilgrim saints for a safe journey. So, a good death and a safe journey. So, let me tell you a little bit about the story of St. Ursula. I'll tell you first what the actual historical evidence is. There is a stone, probably from the 5th century, that now is encased in the Church of St. Ursula in Cologne, and it talks about someone who rebuilds the Church of the Martyrs. It doesn't say how many, and it doesn't call them virgin martyrs. So we assume that, yes, there must have been some people martyred there. But during the Middle Ages, and I don't think I'm going to go step by step because it would just take too long, but during the Middle Ages, the story grew up. And I
do kind of think of it as a kind of sacred fairy tale, and you'll see why when I tell you the story. And the name of the princess who leads the 11,000 Virgin Martyrs of Lyon is established to be Saint Ursula. She is supposed to be a Christian princess, and her companions who were martyred by the pagan Huns in the 5th century. The story is told in Jacobus de Voragine's Golden Legend. And remember, the word legend to us may mean, oh, something that's not true, but it's a good story. But legend comes from the word reading. So these are golden readings, not something mythological. They were believed to be true, the stories of the saints. And there you see Saint Ursula. And she has a Schutzmantel, or a mantle of protection, which she is enclosing the saints, or some of the 11,000 saints who would represent her her 11,000 companions. The Schutzmantel, as we'll see later, is also used by the Virgin Mary. So it's a, I guess you could say, a kind of appropriation. So, okay. Once upon a time, there was a Christian princess of Britain. Her parents had thought they were not going to have children. They had prayed to God, and they had this wonderful daughter. She was famous for her beauty, for her virtue, for her wisdom. And the pagan prince of Brittany hears about her and sort of falls in love with her reputation. And he says he's going to marry her, and he wants to marry her. So his father sends ambassadors to Ursula's father, the king. One of the stories of this gives her father's name, Deo Notus. Now, that word, that means God knows. So presumably someone was writing her father, whose name only God knows. No, God knows. We don't. And someone made it into a proper name. So father, Deo Notus. So essentially the pagan king makes an offer that makes an offer to them that they cannot refuse. He says, if you don't let my son marry your daughter, we will lay waste to your kingdom. Oh, well, Dad doesn't quite know what to do, but Ursula does. Ursula has a vision. And the angel essentially says to Saint Ursula, well, accept, but make some conditions. And so Ursula says, okay, I'll marry you if you become Christian. And not just say it, you have to study. I think it's 3 years. And during that time, the pagan king will provide ships for her and 10 noble virgins, and each one of them will be given 1,000 handmaidens. So you have 11 noble virgins and 11,000 handmaidens. So the 11,000 virgins are approximate. And they will make a pilgrimage to Rome. They will travel down the Rhine, essentially. And as the story develops, lots of other people join them eventually. Now, there are many images of Saint Ursula. She's a very popular saint. One reason is because at one point, the people of Cologne were beefing up their fortifications, essentially, and they dug into the field of Ursula, as they called it, and found bones. They dug into an old Roman cemetery, but they thought they'd found the bones of the martyrs, so they could send those out as relics all over Europe. So the cult of Ursula and the 11,000 Virgin Martyrs of Cologne spread. Now, many of these pictures show scene, and some of them, I admit, are a bit boring. You know, we get off the boat in this city, and then they'll have the city arms, and then we get back on the boat, and then we get off in another city, and then we have the city arms, and then we get, and it's, you know, it's a little bit boring. Memling doesn't do that. He condenses. He's showing this story in three scenes, or three scenes on each side of the shrine, so in six scenes. And the interesting thing to me about that also is that the scenes that he's doing, he's not doing the negotiation for the hand of the princess. He's showing the things that are really relevant. The sacraments, we'll see, the pilgrimage, and the martyrdom. So on this side, we see three scenes: the arrival in Cologne, the arrival in Basel, and then the arrival in Rome. And then on the other side, we'll also take a look at those scenes. They return to Basel, Ursula's companions martyred, and then St. Ursula is martyred in Cologne. So this is a detail of the scene showing the 11,000 virgin martyrs disembarking at Cologne. And this is where they're sailing down the Rhine. They are not shown in 5th century garments. They're shown in 15th century garments. Remember, there are no archaeologists at the time. So all of the sacred stories, sometimes are shown as though they were happening right there. And you see that he loves to show these detailed cityscapes and detailed landscapes. Well, this one, mostly a cityscape, of course. And the maidens are charming. You might also notice the little girl here in the charming maiden in the lavender garment holding up, from the back. That actually is a kind of altered quotation from Stefan Lochner's Girl in Green. Here she's a girl in lavender instead. Now, you'll notice that there are actual buildings from Cologne, in the background. There's the Byron Turm, or the Bavarian Tower, which is the tower that you see on the far left. You can also see Gross St. Martin's. That gross does not mean the same thing in German as it does in English. It means large. So large St. Martin's, Gross St. Martin's. And then there is the choir of Cologne Cathedral. And you can see this structure next to it with a crane coming off of the top. They were actually building the choir of Cologne Cathedral in the 15th century. The building of Cologne Cathedral goes from the 14th century right up through the 19th century, when they actually rediscovered the design for the facade and put it up. And then, of course, one of the beautiful, beautiful late Gothic churches. So these are actually what the buildings look like. Now, we could argue and say, well, maybe he saw a drawing of them, but I think it's pretty clear that Memlinck was in Cologne at some point. It's just the way he would get from Zelligenstadt to Brussels and to Bruges would be probably to go up, well, it would be down the Rhine, I guess, but anyway, we go north along the Rhine, get to Cologne, and then, it's a sort of straight shot over to Flanders, to Brussels, and then on to Bruges. So that'd be the normal way the roads would go. So it seems quite likely that he would have at least gone through Cologne when he is, going from his hometown to Flanders. It's also possible that he spent some time there. Sometimes we speculate that he, we see some evidence that he certainly saw works by Stefan Lochner. I just mentioned our girl in lavender here, and there's elements in his Last Judgment that are, much transformed, but you can see some influence. Presumably he had actually gone to Cologne and seen these buildings. And there you see them up close. There's Gross St. Martin's, the crane, and the choir that is being built at the time. Now, you also see this little two windows here in one of the buildings in Cologne. So I did a little blow up of this. And you have this sort of ghostly angel flying in, and there's Ursula sitting up in bed with her, sort of hands in a prayerful position. She's having a visitation by an angel. And so when they got to Cologne, the angel comes to visit St. Ursula, and she tells Ursula that when she and her companions return to Cologne, they will be martyred. And they're very happy. She goes and tells them, and they're just so happy. Now, why are they happy? They're happy because that means they'll go to heaven. Martyrs are baptized in their blood. So it wipes out all their sins. They gave the ultimate for their faith. They do not pass purgatory. They don't go to purgatory. They go directly to heaven. Now, as I said, Memling condenses. He doesn't show every stop on the way. He just picks a couple of cities, Cologne, and then Basel. And here we see the maidens have arrived in Basel. They're getting out of the ships. And you can see them walking. They're going to go walking over the Alps. It looks like they're off for a little stroll that day. But a little winding road looking up and then distant mountains. Well, you know, the Rhine only goes so far. If you're going to go to Rome, you know, you got to get off and go on foot. You can't sail through the Alps. So there you see the procession of the maidens. And one of the interesting things is that he does not have accurate buildings for Basel, so it's imaginary Basel. One of the towers, however, we can recognize, and this, of course, is what the tower looks like today. It might not have had all of those parts in the 15th century, but you can see the bottom of it, and if you would sort of take out a section, it looks very, very much like the Tower of Brussels. Town Hall Tower. And so, you know, it shows us that Memling was in Brussels, or so a drawing of it, but more likely was in Brussels and made some drawings. And yeah, he doesn't know what Basel looks like, evidently, so he just substitutes the Brussels Tower. And then they get to Rome. Can you see them coming through this archway? They've come over the Alps and they're walking down the street, and there's a big crowd of them. Right in front of the Lateran Baptistry or something, but right in front of this big ecclesiastical building. And Ursula is being greeted by Pope Cyriac. Now, her bridegroom, her fiancé, by this time has joined her. In the actual story, it's at Mainz, but he's not showing Mainz, so he's showing him in Rome with the other martyrs to be. You'll notice that the Pope is wearing a red dalmatic suitable for a feast day of the martyrs. Oh, and I should also mention something about Pope Cyriac. Why is there no Pope Cyriac in the list of popes? Well, says the story, or the explanation, Pope Cyriac and some of his cardinals and some of the other clergy decided to join the Virgin Martyrs to be, because they also wanted to be martyred. So the people who stayed behind, the cardinals who stayed behind, were just so furious that the Pope had left, that they struck his name from all the records. So only in, I think, Schonau, where Elizabeth of Schonau has the visions that tell some of these stories, including Pope Cyriac, do they have Cyriac in their list of popes. So an explanation of some of the historical flaws, if you will, in the story. You'll notice that the sacraments are being emphasized here. Remember how important the sacraments would be, of course, for the people in the hospital as well. You have Ursula in the background taking communion. You have her bridegroom. He's now been converted to Christianity, presumably, and he's making probably his first confession. So his sins get wiped out. And then, of course, you know, Ursula wasn't just taking a little cruise. She was busy converting all of the 11,000 virgin martyrs and all the other people who joined them. I mean, here you're seeing some male figures. That was one of the problems. When they dug up that cemetery, they found bones of pregnant women. They found men. They found a tombstone that they decided was Ursula's bridegroom, actually. And they decided that what was happening was you start off with 11,000 virgins, but other people joined them. And it seemed to be most of the royalty, actually, of the Rhineland comes and joins them to be martyred. So we see baptism, confession, and the Eucharist. So these are saving sacraments. And here we have detail of Pope Cyriac. Okay, other side. Other side of the shrine shows the return to Basel. And now you see the boats are crowded, not just with virgins and seamen, but also with the Pope. There's a cardinal there, some people who look like they might be wealthy burghers, couple of cardinals. So, you know, you have clergy and others have joined the martyrs to return to Cologne. Okay. The last two scenes are essentially, they have a background that unites them. So you think of those two parts of the same story or event. They have arrived in Cologne, and they find that the Huns are besieging the city of Cologne. And the Huns, you know, see these boatloads of Christians. They fall upon them and kill them and slaughter them all. I'll point out a few things in the boat. Some of them look very serene because they're happy to be martyred, presumably. And you'll see that the bridegroom is being stabbed through the chest and is falling back into the arms of Saint Ursula. They never got married. She'd be able to remain a virgin martyr. But they all go to heaven is the idea. After they've killed all of the companions of Ursula, actually there is a story about one who hid and then came out on the next day to be martyred. So she's hiding somewhere. But at any rate, the Huns were so taken with Ursula's beauty that they brought her back to the camp where the Hunnish king says, "I want to marry you." "Yeah, you just killed all my friends and you want to marry me. Okay." Ursula refuses him. Big surprise. And you see her up with her hand. "Nope, don't want to marry you." The golden legend says she's so angry. The king is so angry that he picks up a bow and arrow and shoots her dead. But as we'll see when we look at this a little closer, it's kind of ambiguous who the king may be. So here we see the Huns killing the companions of Saint Ursula, and you might notice that you see the buildings from Cologne, the Byron Term, St. Maria Leiskirk, I think the Church of the Holy Apostles, and Gros St. Martin's. And supposedly this is a very happy ending because they both get to heaven. And then we're seeing Ursula here refusing the Hunnish king. You'll notice that you've got some of the Huns, and they're all wearing contemporary armor, you know, not 5th century armor, 15th century plate armor, and some, there's a padded jerkin for one of the lower ranking, ordinary soldiers. But you'll notice they're running into the other scene, and some people are even shooting from this scene to the other one. And you might also notice that they have some Germanic symbols up in the pennant that's flying overhead. And of course we see in the background Kölner Dom and the crane. So we have, I guess you would say, three candidates for who the king might be. Is he the guy in red with a turban? So he's dressed a little bit differently and he's got his hand over his heart. Is he the armored fellow next to Ursula, whose gesture mirrors hers? Or is he the archer? Because the golden legend says that the king picks up a bow and arrow and kills her. Or is he a soldier who's following the orders of the king? Not 100% clear, but, you know, there is Ursula refusing with her hand up and about to be shot with an arrow. So an arrow becomes one of her attributes. You might notice that they're forming, you know, they're going back into space. Everybody has their own space to be in. And so that leaves the foreground a little bare, but there's a little dog. It looks like a kind of miniature whippet. And he's looking up with devotion, perhaps, to Saint Ursula. Now, is he just something to fill the space? But you can see how daintily his paws are crossed. He seems like a very devout little dog, doesn't he? And so we remember the symbolism of the dog representing fidelity. I am faithful. And perhaps he is symbolic, as well as a nice little addition to the painting, that indicating that Ursula is faithful unto death. And I also blew this up so you could see the little tiny strokes. Remember, this is not a huge painting. So little tiny details that make up all of these naturalistic details here of the chain mail, and there's our little dog. And one thing that I definitely wanted you to see was the reflection in the armor. And you know, if this is the curved breastplate of the man standing next to her, and you can see Ursula with her hand raised, you can see the archer, and it really does follow both the rules of optics in late medieval Renaissance texts on optics, which are taken from observation. So, you know, this is how it would look in a curved surface. I had a friend who did that. She read some things from the contemporary scientific knowledge about optics, and it's Diane Cilia, and she wrote this wonderful little paper, and I said to her, it's probably she can't prove it. You know, did Memling actually read some of this scientific literature, or was it just that he was observing and, you know, looked at things, and this is how, you know, they would appear on a curved surface. But, you know, this is a tiny little detail blowing up. And remember, we have, of course, the cityscape of Cologne, city view of Cologne. And there's the Kölner Dome closed up with the crane. And I took a picture of Gross St. Martin's, the tower above these sort of modern apartment houses. And you can see there's slight differences. Actually, of course, most of the churches of Cologne were bombed out during World War II, and they had to be rebuilt. And Gross St. Martin's, I think even in the 70s, it still wasn't open. But as you can see, I can take a picture of it. And there you have, you know, the charming female saints, detailed naturalism, and even those reflections, those optical. Now, one of the subjects that Memling portrayed over and over again would be the Virgin and Child enthroned. And undoubtedly the reason he portrayed it over and over again was because it was very, very popular with his patrons. You know, people would order them. This one, fairly small, is in the National Gallery in Washington. It is not dated, but you know, there's been the assumption that it might be around 1485, but a little later than some of the others. And you can see there is the Virgin and Child with that same, well, not identical, but with a cloth of honor and a baldachin here with the little tab sort of fluttering. And then you have this arch with the porphyry columns sculpture and beautiful vistas out the window. As I said, Memling is well known for these beautiful, calm, serene landscapes with the winding roads and little buildings and trees and bushes and just this perfect little world outside the window. We have two musical angels. One has stopped playing his music and is handing the Christ Child an apple. Mary is reading. The Christ Child's ruffling up her book, and another angel continues to play with the harp. Now, we know apples are sometimes considered to be the fruit of the tree of knowledge and refer to original sin because of the, you know, the name of the apple in Latin was so similar to the word evil, mala and malum. So here the angel is offering an apple to the Christ Child. And although it looks like, you know, just something, oh, a little baby's reaching for fruit, it reminds us that Christ is the new Adam who redeems the sin of the first Adam. And when we see, you know, Christ in association with a book, we remember that Christ is known as the Word, the Verbum in Latin, or the Logos in Greek, from the first verse in John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And, you know, Memling has taken this, you know, this idea of having an archway, which we saw in Roger van der Weyden, and you know, using carvings to complete or intensify the meaning. You have your beautiful serene landscapes. You have little putti up here. Putti are little baby boys with wings.
One is a puteaux, and you see them frequently in Italian Renaissance art. So this shows some influence from Italy. Memling influenced the Italians, and the Italians influenced Memling. There is cross-cultural motifs going on here. The child, the putti, seem to be holding balls, I suppose, reference to the orb of the universe. And of course, as I said, they come out of classical antiquity from little Eros figures or little loves that assist Cupid. But here they have become angels. And then you see these sort of Gothic canopies over two statues. And the statues show the prophet and king, David, the author of the Psalms, which sometimes are interpreted as prophecies. And he's holding the lyre or the harp there. And then on the other side is Isaiah. And Isaiah, of course, a very famous prophet. The Vulgate version of the Bible says that a virgin will conceive and bear a child, is one of the prophecies of Isaiah. And of course, the Man of Sorrows also comes from Isaiah. He's holding, I don't think you can make it out, but he's holding a saw because the story is that he was sawed in half. So that helps identify which prophet he is. And then, of course, we have the vine scrolls that go around the arch and remind us of the wine of the Eucharist, the blood of Christ. Angels are wearing liturgical garment, the red dalmatic worn at the feast of martyr, the mass, and then the white alb. Now, as I say, Memling painted many, many paintings of the Madonna and Child. This particular design was a popular design, and he varied it, sometimes just a little bit, as you can see here. Sometimes there's a whole different setting, but these are very, very close to this, but each one has slight variations. One of them is from a triptych in Vienna, and incidentally, the donor is overpainted. There was an ecclesiastical donor in the X-ray, so you can see the highlights there. So the painting was probably acquired by someone else, and a new donor painted in. But you can see here more putti, different sacrifice of Isaac, and the sacrifice of Jephro's daughter, or the sculpture there. And then on the far side, on the left, is a painting that is in Florence in the Uffizi, and it went down to Italy. And the backgrounds actually became very influential. Fra Bartolomeo copied that little background with a mill in it in one of his paintings, which today is in New York. But here you can see the putti now are colored as though they're little living creatures, and they have this Italianate garland or swag that they're holding. So, you know, a little very popular, a little difference in variants. I should probably tell you also that Memling, we have more paintings by Hans Memling than any other of the early Netherlandish masters. And there's 90-some. I mean, you can't give an exact number because some works, some people will say, no, no, that's not by Memling, it's a follower. And someone else will say, oh, yes, it's by Memling. But around 95-ish.